Hey, everybody, it's Jon Schnepp. Welcome to episode 23 of Collider's Heroes, where we talk about TV and cinematic supervillains and superheroes and everything that revolves superpowers and awesomeness. This week, as always, we've got John Campea hosting with me.
Superpowers and awesomeness. It's a very wide umbrella for us to cover today, folks.
That's right. And also under the umbrella of this week's episode, we also have returning with us, Robert Peterson. What's going on?
I'm doing really well. I'm glad to be back.
Yeah. Good to have you, man.
Thank you.
Well, let's rock right into the very first story of the week. Let's talk about Civil War leaking out online. We've got little QuickTimes that are silent, horrible quality that have now been pretty much pulled from every site available. But for those few people who weren't at D23 and were able to just see a little bit momentarily of the flavor that was the D23 sizzle reel that they had put on, I guess Stephen Lamb is fired. Or whatever his job used to be, that guy, because his name was like burned in to every clip of that footage. Stephen Lang or Lamb or whatever his name was, that dude's gone, you know? So did you get a chance to see any of this? John actually saw the actual crystal clear, crispy footage with sound design and everything at D23. This is the first time I got to see like little nuggets of what he had told me about, which is basically like Captain America fighting Crossbones, Hawkeye fighting Scarlet Witch, a whole bunch of dudes all from different teams all running at each other, and like which looked like basically a FedEx shipping yard, just a bunch of weird trucks behind them. I was like, what are they just, is this like a scrimmage match? It felt like it was kind of fake. Like, I don't think that that's the actual Civil War. They're like, sort of like, all right, if we were going to fight, which we're not, let's fight right now and do it. Let's just take care of it. I think it feels like it was too comical. Like, are we still having dinner? You know, that kind of thing. So did you get a chance to see any of it?
It was quite a spelunking expedition to find those clips, but I did track them down, yeah. And I had the same reaction to the setting as you, John. I wonder if they're going to CG in like a more fanciful background, because it seemed lo-fi, but I'll keep an open mind.
Yeah, I'm sure that that's not like the ultimate fight.
Final,
like,
yeah.
Look, we're gonna fight behind like some kind of shipping truck yard. You know, that's really all.
Like
I
two
saw.
Rival street gangs meet us in the FedEx yard.
Totally.
At 9 p.m.
Yeah,
you can bring bats, no guns. Those are the rules.
Definitely, yeah. it felt like that was like a very early moment in the film.
If it is, here's the reason why I suspect that it's not. That it is actually the fight is because if it is just like some early training exercise, which some people are speculating, why are they already on their correct teams? I mean, that would just be a little too on the nose, you know, that if it was, you know, Captain America and he had War Machine beside him and, you know, let's say, because when they're running towards each other, I think Sebastian Stan is a part of that. Like he's already back. So, I mean, training exercise, it's a little too accurate.
Let's take training exercise out of the equation. I'm saying, like, they're fighting, but there are no stakes. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm saying they probably all had a big meeting. There was an argument, and Cap is like, let's take it outside. And cut to them all standing outside, and they run at each other. There's never the stakes. There's never a moment that Hawkeye is thinking, I'm going to kill you, you know, Black Widow.
I don't think you're
going to
get that in any of this, though, because my impression that I got, both from the post-credit scene in Ant-Man, when they're talking about Tony in that, and it's not adversarially they're talking about Tony. I don't get the feeling that in any of this movie you're going to get any of these people want to like really harm each other. I don't think it's going to come to that. I think there's a more of a political play thing happening here. But I mean, we'll see. I do know this. If that's the big fight, I think people are going to be disappointed. I think the movie's going to be awesome, but I think some people are going to be disappointed that that's the big fight. I think people are kind of envisioning this 45-minute, you know, half a city getting destroyed as they battle throughout a countryside or something like that. I don't think that's coming. I don't think it's going to be in this movie.
I agree with you. I don't think that's going to be in the movie. I think the Civil War is going to be quite much larger and much gorier and bloodier, as far as like, this isn't going to be like just like a, you know, you said this, all right, well, we're going to fight, you know, I don't know. It doesn't feel like that's going to be the end. But anyway, if you guys got a chance to see it, I think it's still available somewhere, maybe on Cosmic Book Soup News. You can check it out. It could be there. All right, let's move on. Spider-Man speaks out. So we've got Andrew Garfield kind of clearing the air a little bit, or as much as he's legally allowed to, without without getting sued. Talking about his portrayal of Spider-Man and Peter Parker, mentioning that his Comic-Con appearance that was long before either of the two films actually came out was actually his truest acting as Spider-Man. He says, "I couldn't rescue those films, the films that, you know, Spider-Man 1 and 2. He's basically kind of defending himself against a lot of the people like myself who hated Amazing Spider-Man 2. And actually liked Amazing Spider-Man 1, but just felt like the second one was just a gigantic disaster. What do you think, John, about his comments?
Look, I'm a big fan of Andrew Garfield. Everybody knows this. I think he was robbed of an Academy Award.
For the Facebook movie.
Yes, yes.
Right, not for Spider-Man.
Not for Spider-Man. Right. For The Social Network. I thought he was robbed of an Academy Award for that. I'm a huge Andrew Garfield fan. If you've watched any of our shows for any period of time, you know this. And I thought the first Amazing Spider-Man with Andrew Garfield was great. And I was disappointed with the second. I still enjoyed it, but it was a huge step down. And a lot of other people out there just flat out hated the film. And while I did not hate it, I can totally see why other people did. Like, it was a big step down from the other ones. But Andrew Garfield needs to shut his mouth. Shut your mouth, Andrew. I mean, you got paid big money to be, you know, to be a star and be in these movies and stuff like that. And you know what? You know, and everybody likes to say, oh, no, it's good when actors get to... No, shut up. You know, if I'm a producer... And I'm thinking about doing movies, and I'm thinking about I have big blockbuster films, and I'm going to be putting a lot of money into that. Now, do I want to work with Andrew Garfield, knowing that if things don't go his way and he doesn't get cast again in the role, and we got to part ways, that he's now going to walk off and crap talk on my movies and my properties? Hell no. You know, you got paid big money. You had no problem cashing the checks. Then shut your mouth. I don't lie about it. I mean, I don't expect somebody like Andrew Garfield to come out and go, no, I really love those movies if that's not what you thought. I don't expect him to lie. But at the same time, you know, censor yourself. Just say, you know, I had a great time working on the films. Or say, you know, that was a great time in my life. Or say, I was thrilled to be cast in it. Or, you know, hey, I understand not everybody loved them. But, you know, but don't start crap talking. You know, I couldn't rescue those films.
Right.
Am I ever, as a producer, going to pay you to work in any of my projects? Yeah. No. And I'm one of your biggest fans. Shut up. Anyway, that's just my thought.
What do you think, Robert?
Well, John, very, very well said. Very, very fiery. And setting aside the topic of airing your dirty laundry in public, which, of course, is bad form, I'll tell you, this is just walk with me on this one. This reminded me of years ago when I was very young, and I had just gotten to L.A., and I was doing a play. This will give you an idea how long ago this was, and I was, like, trying to do plays. And I remember a guy in the show that I was in, he was cast in an episode of Star Trek. I think it was Voyager that was going on. Again, revealing my age. And I can remember, you know, I was very young and very naive. And he was very snotty about it. And he was very, like, condescending to, like, Star Trek fandom. And I can remember as a youngster really bristling at that, thinking, like, oh, like, aren't you excited to be in this show that I like so much? And I thought back to Andrew Garfield and pivoting and flashing forward to today. I was thinking about Andrew Garfield's speech at Comic-Con and just how heartfelt that was.
It was awesome.
It was awesome. Yeah, it was so great. It was so sweet, and it was so sincere. Like, you could tell it was not just some act that he was putting on. And I thought, wow, what a very special thing to have this this confluence of talent and material, and to get an actor into a part that he felt so honored to be in and so privileged to be a part of. And again, I'm completely skipping over the politics of the reboots and the Marvel, you know, cinematic universe and all that. But that's what sprang to mind for me when I heard about this.
Yeah, and you know what? Here's the other sad part is that it makes him come across just as sour.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even if he's not, and personally, I believe he's not sour. I think he understands the business and understands, look, if they did make the deal with Sony or with Marvel that it kind of necessitated rebooting the character, mm-hmm. I think he understands. I don't think he is sour, but it makes you look sour. Right, it makes you look like you're just being a crybaby about the whole thing. And I think he's better than that. And I just think he needs to be smarter about how he handles these types of situations moving forward.
Yeah, I have to agree. There's certain things that happen when you're working in, especially in media, where you're working with a lot of other people. There's a lot of other people. Like, I've worked with people that I never want to work with again. Am I going to publicly shame them or out them or say bad things about them? Only to my friends. But publicly, no, I won't. Yeah. So, you know, it's with him, he should have just said, you know, I'm sorry. You know, I'm sorry things didn't work out. I'm moving on to other projects. I'm looking forward to what they do with Spider-Man at Marvel. And he did say that in his and what he was saying. He did say, I'm looking forward to what they do with Spider-Man at Marvel. But it was tinged with a lot of, I don't want to get into too much detail, but then what with that caveat of, but I will say, then dipping into this kind of a sour negativity.
It's like, you know? My ex-girlfriend, look, she's super sweet. she's really nice. She does a lot of cherry work.
But
she's a total bitch. You know, it's kind of like saying that.
Yeah, it is. It is sort of saying that. And it's like, you know, I mean, in this biz, you know, that's going to happen a lot. So you have to just kind of roll with it and move on to the next project. Yeah. And he got a chance to do something that very few people on this planet will ever get a chance to do, which is play Spider-Man. It was a dream role for him. It might not have been the ideal version of Spider-Man that he wanted to do. But once again, that's working in the film world. You're working with a bunch of people. It's never just your pure idea. Right. It's a whole bunch of people throwing their ideas together to make what is either a TV series or a movie. So hopefully, you know, Tom Holland will be awesome as Spider-Man. We'll all be
fingers crossed. Well, let me ask you this question. As somebody who, like, I still mildly entertained Spider-Man 2, but I thought it was a huge step down. You hated Spider-Man 2. Do either of us think Andrew Garfield was the problem?
No.
Yeah, and I think that's for the most case. I think even most people who really disparaged on the Spider-Man movies, I think most of them would say Andrew Garfield wasn't the problem. So I don't know why he would feel the need to kind of, like you put it, like defend himself, because I think most people understand, nah, he brought it to the role. It wasn't his fault.
Well, I think that happens with a lot of actors and actresses.
Yeah,
because they're the public face of it. Usually, you know, it's like with films, less so television, but with movies, the directors take that hit. If the movie is a failure, you're a failure. Mm. If the movie's a success, welcome to your next three pictures, you know, or whatever. Yeah. With actors, they have much more of a chance to, even while they're filming, they've already got their next four or five movies lined up. So by the time that movie, whatever it is, rolls out, if you've got a good agent and you're on a hot streak, you've just lined up your next three or four years of work. Most of it's already in the can by the time that movie, like The Amazing Spider-Man 2, rolls out. So he's got a lot of other films that he's worked on and done that are, you know, probably a high production value. Also, he's able to do a lot of different acting roles, techniques within that. So he's a great actor. So, you know, I think he probably takes it a little more personally, though, because he was Spider-Man.
Yeah.
So let's move on to Michael Shannon flipping out, literally, with flippers.
Flipping out, well
so,
said.
A few weeks ago, Michael Shannon was talking about wearing flippers on his fingers while on set for Batman v Superman, and he was stuck in the bathroom while Zack Snyder was looking for him to, you know, where's Shannon? I need him on set. Now he's saying none of that was real, and that he's not in the film, but he is, only as a ghost, like Jor-El, but also maybe that Doomsday will be wearing flippers in the next movie. Can I have the drugs that this man is on? I just want half of the drugs that this guy is taking. I mean, because he's talking about, like, he's not in the movie, yet he is, but he's like a ghost. Like, so he's saying he did VO, but obviously we all know, we've seen Man of Steel. Being a ghost actually means being filmed in it. It's not just voiceover, like, you know, like, use the force, Superman. It's like, no, he's there in the room, like, hey, what's up? I'm a cool, realistic hologram.
Just like the ultimate crossover you just did, use the force, Superman.
That's right. That's, somebody make a fan film. Oh, wait, they already did. If you saw that Batman versus Darth Vader, that was incredible. Superman shows up. He's trapped by Kryptonian forces on the Death Star. Cool fan film. So, yeah, Michael Shannon, look, we talked about this earlier on Movie Talk earlier today. We love Michael Shannon. I think he's incredible.
Oh, he's awesome. He's awesome.
Amazing actor. Like, he steals films. He's like, he's good. Like, when he shows up a movie, you're like, oh, what's he gonna, you know, what's he gonna bring to the table? Always something awesome. So for him, you know, look, he might have just gotten tongue-tied and he might have just slipped a little too much information, and a couple of Warner Brothers bruisers showed up late at night like, Shannon, if you say one more word about the flippers, I'll take it back. And they're hanging him over the ledge like ice, vanilla ice. And it's like, you know, some strong arm tactics, as we know Warner Brothers uses. You know, I think he was like, hey, look, I'm just a ghost. I don't believe him. I think he's Doomsday. But, you know, I could be wrong. We could all be wrong. We're just conjecturing. Maybe he never wore the flippers. What do you think, John?
Well, I mean, look, yeah, I think we don't know what the truth is. But I do know that what the truth is not what's coming out of Michael Shannon's mouth right now. And that's totally fine. He is totally entitled to play this little marketing chess game, the PR chess game, I should say. Totally fine. I don't hold this against him at all. But, you know, when he first made those comments about the flippers, we already believe, it's like, okay, he probably doesn't mean literal flipper. He means some kind of prosthetic or whatever. And, you know, It just, now for him to go back on that and says, oh, no, that was just a joke. Really? Well, you went into a lot of detail and told a lot of story.
You're in a bathroom with these, these flipper things that are all over my fingers.
I could see him saying,
couldn't do something with the flippers.
And then he says, you know, we mentioned this earlier too. He says, okay, I'm not in any costume. I'm just a voiceover. Yeah, what are you doing on set? And if you were, you know, looking back at Russell Crowe in the original film, well, he was the ghost figure, but he was in costume. Mm-hmm. So it's just so much contradictory stuff coming from him. We just go, okay, Shannon, I get it. You're playing the PR game right now. You're trying to spin this. I get it. Kudos to you. Don't hold this against you. But I don't believe a word of it. So I really hope, I'm still holding out hope that it's not supposed to be doomsday. And the reason being is this. I've always said about comic book and changes from the comic material to the big screen. Change the costume. Change the hair color. Change the ethnicity. Change all that kind of stuff. All I've ever really cared about is, look, do you get those core, key essential elements to who the character is? Like with Captain America, they did a lot of departures from the comic book. Mm-hmm. But he was Steve Rogers. He was, you know, too scrawny to make it in the military. He wanted to serve. Through science, they found a way to give him the tools. You know, they captured all those key elements. With Doomsday, if you know anything about Doomsday, you're basically gutting. If you make this the Doomsday, you are gutting everything, all the key core essential things about what makes Doomsday Doomsday, and you're taking it all away. And that I would have a problem with. And it would be really too bad because Doomsday's the type of character you can save and you can build up to because of the type of character that he is and what he represents. To just throw him in as an afterthought thing, oh, we'll turn the Michael Shannon, we'll turn General Zod into it. It's like, it's just, that's not Doomsday. And I'd be disappointed if that's what they did.
I'll play devil's advocate. I personally never thought Doomsday was a good character because he doesn't talk. He's just a mindless killing machine. He's worse than the Hulk. He's just a giant brute. So even though he had this whole origin, this big buildup for the death of Superman.
And his motivation. Comic book, his motivation, too, came from that. Look, why he's got such a hate on for Superman. I mean, it was, when you
genetically,
know his backstory,
but it's genetically built from, like, you know, we threw a baby on a planet and it didn't survive. Then we threw another baby on a planet. So his origin, to me, has always been, I just don't like his origin.
I've always liked it. I thought you would have, too.
No. For some reason, it didn't ring true enough for me to be, like, a powerful villain because he didn't even talk.
Right.
I mean, it's like, you know, at least I want my villain to at least say, and now my revenge, or, you know, I'm from that that world of villains. I want him to at least be able to talk a little bit. So what do you think, Robert?
John, with all respect, I'll second John on this one. And here's why.
Say you'll second Schnepp because we're both Johns.
Yes. sorry, John Schnepp, yeah.
You're confusing the audience.
In my head, it was J. Owen. and here's why. The thing that always troubled me about Doomsday just from a writing perspective was that, okay, so if the task is to kill Superman, they didn't draw from the existing just like incredible like breadth of mythology for Superman. They basically invented a Superman killing thing. That's what always troubled me about Doomsday just as far as his origin and his mythology. And who knows how they would execute that in this movie? I'm not even thinking about that, how elegantly it would come off. However, I feel like that different adaptations of material, like movies or plays or whatever, or TV shows, they sometimes present the opportunity to gently repair the original text. I could go on ad nauseum about the Lord of the Rings movies and just all the really like thoughtful choices they made about that. And for me, taking an existing character like General Zod and using him as a way to bolster the origin of Doomsday could, and I stress could, really work in like a good, you know, just, you know, economical, thoughtful way. Much in the same way over in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, how like they're really making some choices just to save space and pull things together, like having Tony be the inventor of Ultron, for example. They were like, okay, like Hank's not in the universe yet. Let's just assign that role to Tony. So I think it could work. And I also wanted to touch briefly on one theme that's been welling up in today's episode are just these terrifying forces from these studios if you speak out or like let something slip, like Michael Shannon. Like, as somebody who's been thrown out of Hall H, God help me, I just blanch, I shudder to think of like what happened when he let that slip, because I'm sure he was talking about like the bony protrusions or whatever for that prosthetic, you know. So yeah, oh, I hope he's okay.
Well, even, but you know what's funny is he lets one thing slip and then within the same breath, breath and says, I was never on set. I was doing voiceover, though. Why are you even saying that?
I am a ghost character.
Right, I am a ghost character. Why are you saying that? That's the funny thing.
And there's already been a shot of him in costume in one of the trailers. Right. Like, he was on set. Yeah.
In a zipper bag. It's all CG. Who knows? It's a life cast. I don't know what it is. But if he's saying he's doing a voiceover, it's either one of two things. It's either Superman having a nightmare where Zod is like, I told you I'd destroy your planet, whatever, he wakes up. Or he's having a nightmare about killing Zod. So it's a dead body Zod, like, you killed me just like you killed, blah, blah, whatever. So it's a dream nightmare that Kal-El's having. Or he's voicing Doomsday.
Like they, I mean, look, another thing they could do, they could be like, there's been a lot of speculation and there's some basis for the speculation. We know that, you know, LexCorp has Zod's body. He is Kryptonian. What if they, you know, genetically mutate that thing and turn him into this other thing and they just put the label Doomsday on him?
Totally.
Right. Yeah, yeah. In that case, then you'd have a completely CG character, maybe not looking like the Doomsday we know at all, maybe looking very much like him. And, you know, Shannon is doing the voice of that, doing like a Vin Diesel in The Iron Giant.
Sure.
But still intelligent, still talking, whatever. I mean, that could be one way he's approaching
it. Or still has the very limited elements of what Zod was. So even though the military might think they can control this Doomsday, it's actually, I want to kill Superman. Or they're building it as a Doomsday device where it's like, if this alien ever gets out of control, LexCorp has this thing that we've been, you know, building. Who knows how they're going to introduce it? But, you know, we're all pretty sold on the idea that Doomsday is going to show up in this movie, you know, because it kind of makes sense in a certain sense if they go with this kind of storyline that we're all making up. I don't know, because no one sent us the official reading script.
So this is all speculation.
Yeah, we're all speculators.
Another Batman v Superman related thought.
Yeah.
Forgive me for sort of jumping lanes here. Oh, pun intended. My girlfriend's at Burning Man this week, and I am using that opportunity to watch all of the Fast and Furious movies.
Nice.
I had seen a couple, and I'd been wanting to see the rest. There's so much that I like about them. But also, I was really curious to see Gal Gadot. I don't know how to pronounce her last
Gal
name.
Gadot.
Gal Gadot, yeah. You know, just curious to see her like on screen and in action, just like see what she's like. And just because I'm really, you know, I'm excited to see her play Wonder Woman. And I was wondering if either of you had seen these movies. I couldn't get much of a read just because her character is always just like just in this very like soft-spoken, sultry mode. And for me, and I, for one, I imagine Wonder Woman being like a field marshal. Like she should be kind of like George Patton, like shouting orders and stuff like that. Do you guys have any thoughts or feelings?
I didn't get a read from her from those Fast and Furious movies because she's not that much of a character in those films. So whatever the producers and whatever Zack Snyder saw in those, you know, tryouts where they had a bunch of different people trying out and reading the lines, she knocked it out of the park, you know, for that role.
Right.
So, you know, they saw something in her that none of us have seen yet, and she's Wonder Woman. So she has to have some chops, and I think it's Gal Gadot.
Gal Gadot?
I've been corrected both ways. I've said Gal Gadot and been corrected to Gal Gadot. I've said Gal Gadot, been corrected to Gal Gadot. I still think it was a monumental error. I think it was a horrible, horrible choice. And I think it reveals a level of sexism, to be honest, that still exists in thing. Because this is the argument I've always made. But I am, by the way, I am now officially on the Gal Gadot cheerleading squad because I want this movie to be awesome and I want her to crush it. But that being said, you know, I've always said with Wonder Woman being the most iconic female superhero in history, okay, and that has never been on the big screen before. Let's say for a moment that Batman had never been on the big screen before and they were about to cast the first Batman. And if they came to us then and said, we have cast Gus Miller, a former welder who 2 years ago took up acting, has had a couple of tiny roles that he was horrible in, the tiny roles that he was in, but we're making this guy Batman. The fan community would have lost their minds. There would have been complaints and demonstrations of, you are not showing respect to the character, you're blah, 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 but they went out and they got Ben Affleck. They went out before and they got Christian Bale. They went out before not just guys who had a name recognition, because name recognition is irrelevant. It's, do they have a background in this? Do they have talent? They went out and cast a Broadway actor to play Cyborg, for a matter of fact. But because it's Wonder Woman, because it's a female character, they went out and got a woman who hadn't been acting all that long. Up until recently, she had another profession altogether, and she's only had a couple of small roles in which she didn't impress anybody. But because it's a woman, she's hot. Therefore, it's fine. I think it reveals an underlying sexism, unfortunately, that we would have demanded more respect for the character had it been a male character that we were concerned about. But because it's a female character, everybody's just concerned about, well, is she hot? Okay. Then whatever. I think there would have been riots in the street if we had gotten Gus to play Batman, but nobody gives a crap that we went out and got Gal Gadot to play Wonder Woman.
I disagree with what you're saying. I think it's almost reverse racism, what you're saying. It's reverse sexism. Reverse sexism, because they, like I said, we're not in that room, so we don't know. And you're saying you're on the side of Gal Gadot now, but what you're saying is they just went out and cast someone who doesn't fit the property. They cast Michael Keaton as Batman, and people went nuts. Sure, people absolutely hate it because they cast a comedian to play what everyone thinks of, and a short comedian too, what everyone thinks of as a 6'5" giant ripped dude, Batman. People were, I mean, the letters that hit Warner Brothers and DC, and they didn't even have the internet back then. It was an insane level of hatred, and you're destroying our character, and the prejudging. You know, I talk about this a lot with prejudging casting. Same thing with Ben Affleck. People, me and you are the only people that I remember saying, I actually think it's a good choice for Ben Affleck to play Batman, because he's not only is he a super giant Batman fan, but he's grown so much as an actor. I think this should work pretty well. I think Heath Ledger got tons of hatred for Brokeback Mountain. How dare you get the Brokeback Mountain guy to play the Joker? Hugh Jackman, tons of hatred before the movie ever came out, but in a smaller level, because once again, the internet wasn't that giant back then, but people were like, he's 6'5", he's not, he doesn't look like Wolverine. Once again, they didn't even know who Jackman was. He was a Broadway actor in Australia. I can't go with this kind of like, just because someone's from another craft, like, hey, this person was a model, just like Channing Tatum. Granted, Channing Tatum's first couple films, dud boy.
Oh, yeah, he's terrible. He was
just,
terrible the first seven
like
years
Gal
of his career.
But just like Gal was pretty much, you know, you watch those Fast and Furious, she's barely, she's not on the radar even when she's talking.
But the two big differences, though, with all the examples you just raised are two very key things in all of the examples you said. One, they were all established career actors with experience leading films, with experience having rave reviews, whether it was in comedy or a different genre or not. All of them were experienced, talented actors.
Not Channing Tatum,
Well, Tatum is the great example, though, because he was terrible for years and years and years until finally he started getting good. The second example, the second point about all your examples, all male characters. If we don't think the audience thinks that the character being cast in this male role is right for it, we will riot. If it's a female character, nobody seems to care. And no, therein is where I think the sexism was.
No, everyone cared, including you. You were screaming about it when she first got cast.
Yeah, but nobody else was.
No,
everybody else is like,
everyone,
oh, who cares? It's just a girl.
No, that's not true. Everyone online, I read so much hatred for the casting of her, mainly because she doesn't have big breasts. There was a lot of hatred from guys.
Boy, and that's stupid. Yeah,
I agree, but I'm just saying there was a lot of that kind of, she doesn't look like Wonder Woman, the idealized Linda Carter version of Wonder Woman. But, you know, your point that she's not, doesn't have a lot of acting behind her, no one can disagree with that, because you can't really point to anything but these Fast and Furious films to look at her as an actress. But then you look at her, you know, what she's done as a person. She was in the military. She's had all this different training. Whatever she brought with her to that tryout is what we're going to see, hopefully, in the film. And hopefully it's not just 5 minutes and it doesn't make an impact.
It better not, because they've already planned a standalone movie for
her. That's all I'm saying. That'll back up a lot of what you're saying. We're not actually seeing her act in this film. It does not give us what we need to see for her to be in a standalone Wonder Woman film. So I think whatever setup, I mean, remember, this movie got delayed a whole extra year. I think whatever retooling and resetup they did with the script was to make sure that they're setting the stakes out for the rest of the DC, you know, cinematic universe. So,
absolutely.
I mean, it's a lot is riding on this movie that comes out in 7 months. And it's not just, you know, is Superman going to get a sequel? Is Batman going to sequel? It's like, what is this Wonder Woman movie going to be? Is there going to be a Green Lantern or a Flash movie? Or is this all going to implode? You know, I don't think it'll all implode, but there's so much riding on that. And, you know, that's why what you're saying is really important. It's like, is she going to bring what we think that character, that iconic character, needs to have? So, I mean, really, we'll find out, you know?
Yeah, we'll find out. And by the way, I will buy I will buy a Gal Gadot t-shirt. I'm going to wear it to opening night because despite everything I just said, that's all got to be put in the back seat.
Right.
Because she is Wonder Woman and we want this movie to be great. So now I am her biggest fan.
I will buy one after the movie because I'm going to wait and see. I like you, I want her to rock it, but I have to wait and see like what kind of character that Wonder Woman is. Robert, anything?
Oh, just one more thought. John Campea, again, very well said. And I got to tell you, that is one... angle that I hadn't considered this argument from because the sexism angle because when she got cast, I remember the stuff that just purely anecdotally that I read online that really made me feel queasy and upset. I didn't actually read anything about her bust line, but it was about her being too skinny to play the part. I heard a lot of complaints about that.
Oh, yeah, I read that. Yeah, I read that too, which you know, I never understood that because I get it. She's an Amazonian, but she's got a female frame. She can bulk that up. That's okay. But the other thing I've never really understood about that is her strength is mythical. I mean, it's not like she's the Rock who's got it. You got to convince this normal human guy can curl 300 pounds.
Right.
Her power is mythical. And, you know, because she has such a small frame, she doesn't act. It's not like, you know, if I was going to be in a movie and I'm almost 6 feet tall, if I was going to be a movie and I had to play a guy that had a physique that looked like I was an action star, well, I got to probably pack on about 30 pounds of muscle to do that. Because Gal Gadot has such a small frame, she actually doesn't have to put on that much to make it look like a significant difference. So I was never worried about, personally, number one, the bust size argument is just stupid and just not even worth addressing. The fact that she was too small, never worried about, she only needed to put on about 10 pounds of muscle to do it. So, but you know what? You can get any actress to look the part. Mm-hmm. You can. You can get any actress to look the part. It's whether do they have the talent to bring that part to life. That's the part we're going to find out.
And I just had one sort of predicate to what I was saying.
Sure.
Is that the complaints about her being too skinny, I also thought were silly for a lot of the same reasons. Her powers are mythical. And also, a great performance, it has to do from what comes within the actor, what animates them. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned Hugh Jackman. That's a great example because, again, he's 6'5", he's a musical theater guy.
Nothing like Wolverine.
Nothing. Right. And I can remember back in the day, like, I remember, you know, like my buddies in high school, like, oh, Glenn Danzig should play Logan. And like, God, what a botch that would have been.
That would have been
and
such
like,
a botch.
Having him, instead of somebody like Hugh Jackman, who's a real, like, a craftsman and artist, mm-hmm. who really just, like, brought so much thought to it. So anyway, that's all I have.
Good point.
Yeah, for sure. Let's move on to topic number four. Mads Mikkelsen has been cast in Doctor Strange. Now, one of my favorite actors of the last decade, Mads Mikkelsen. See him in the Pusher trilogy. See him in Valhalla Rising. Definitely see him in Hannibal. He's been cast as an unnamed villain in the upcoming Doctor Strange film. Can this cast get any better? John Campea, what do you
well,
think?
Well, first, just to be clear so we don't confuse anybody, he hasn't actually officially been cast yet, but he is in talks. Mm. That means he's already gone through all the early stages. Once you get to the part where the studio's saying, okay, now let us talk to your agent and work out the details, it's almost locked. So, but Joaquin Phoenix was also in talks for Doctor Strange. So, but it's probably happening. It's most probably happening. Awesome. Just awesome. It's funny because the day before this announcement, we were talking about Mads on Jedi Council because he's also going to be in Star Wars Rogue One. Mm. And apparently he said he's not going to be a villain in that. And I was kind of saying, no, it's good that he's stretching his wings, but I love me Mads Mikkelsen as a villain, man. He's so great.
So good.
So few people can really own a good villain, you know? And he's one of the guys who can do it. And then the very next day, it sounds like he's going to be in Doctor Strange. It's like, now you got... like Academy Award nominee Benedict Cumberbatch, you got Academy Award nominee Chiwetel Ejiofor, who probably should have won the Academy Award, but whatever. McConaughey was great, and now you're bringing in a guy of the caliber of Mads Mikkelsen
and Tilda Swinton.
Tilda Swinton is also in there. I mean, there's a million things that can go wrong in a film, but casting is clearly not one of the things going wrong with this film. Just brilliant.
And John got to see at D23. They showed a bunch of like concept art from some of
set
the different
music.
Realms, just the concept art of some of the mystical realms of other dimensions that they're going to go in Doctor Strange. And like, you know, I'm super jealous of that.
They set
like,
it to music and it was like a 2 or 3 minute trailer. Just using still art, it blew my mind.
Awesome.
I was like, it's a Marvel film, so I'm looking forward to it. But it was that footage that made me go, to see what they're going for. And I was like, okay, now I'm freaking out about Doctor Strange.
So they've got that going on. Then they've got that horror movie twist going on. And they've got this crazy cast going on. Come on. What do you think, Robert?
Oh, my goodness. Well, John, I forewarned you about this, but I am just going to unrepentantly sing Mads Mikkelsen's praises in the show Hannibal. I mentioned earlier how adaptation gives you the chance to gently repair material, and you'll find no bigger fan of Thomas Harris's novels than me. I love his books. However, I think you can charitably say they're on the pulpia end of things, and that show, Fuller's show, was just so beautiful and thoughtful and lyrical and dreamlike. And Mikkelsen was just handsome and cadaverous all at once. And just such an incredible, just an immortal, iconic performance. And just the prospect of him in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it fills me with joy.
Yeah, there's something about his acting technique that he brings to every single role, whether he's playing I can't remember what the film was, but he was like looked at as like, oh, a person who was like a pedophile when he wasn't. It was this horrible film where it was like just about him being accused of doing something that he didn't do. And it was what a horrifying but gripping performance that he did in that. Valhalla Rising, basically just playing this silent fighter, basically like Conan. But done so greatly. It's like the Pusher trilogy. Once again, if you haven't seen that, gotta see that film specifically for his role in the first and the second film. He's the lead in the second film. Guy's great. I cannot wait to see what he brings. But Hannibal was like where he just like shined so brightly because everything about that production, John Campea just started recently.
I just binge watched the first season in 3 days. I think it was about 3 days. What kills me about his performance is that he does what Hannibal Lecter does. And in one scene, I'm like, damn it, I want to go to one of these dinner parties. If you've seen the show, you're not talking about Hannibal's constantly holding these dinner parties with people and they don't realize they're eating human flesh.
Right.
But he's so charming and inviting and you're just drawn. There's something so cool about him. And then the coin flips and you're like, he's so terrifying. He's like all in this one character that he brings. Just sick. Sick.
If you guys haven't checked out Hannibal, you've got to watch it. It's the top-notch cinematography, top-notch writing, top-notch acting. I mean, top-notch
sound
directing.
Design.
Sound design alone.
If you are a Amazon Prime member, which I am, but if you are, there's a lot of reasons you should be an Amazon Primer. But if you are, I believe all the episodes right now are available on Amazon Prime.
Oh, that's excellent. I didn't even know
that. And it's part of your Prime membership, so you can just watch it. That's how I'm binge watching it right now.
It's a fantastic series. And once again, I'm glad you mentioned the sound design. That's one of the reasons you have to watch it without commercials. Because the minute it cuts to commercial break, you're outside of this. You've gotten drawn into this weird world that this Hannibal series is based in, but commercials just snap you out of it. And I watched one episode with commercials and never again. It was sort of one of those like, it hasn't been downloaded yet. I guess I'll just watch the commercial version of it.
But we here at Collider Video fully endorse great sponsors. So if any of you out there want to come on in and put up some money, we'll be happy to put in a couple of commercials on Heroes.
Well, look, we at Collider Video.
Break our sound design.
We don't have our sound design like built to be destroyed when your commercial comes in. It's to enhance your commercial. Very different than Hannibal.
That's right. We aim to enhance your commercials.
I had one more thought about Doctor Strange, and it was related to Ant-Man, which I finally caught. And I had mixed feelings about the movie as a whole, but the finale, I assume you've both seen it?
Yes.
Okay, but the finale where, crud, spoilers, can I mention what the finale is? Or
well, Ant-Man, it's already been like the sixth week. If you sweat, you haven't seen Ant-Man
the
yet.
The etiquette of that eludes me sometimes, but in any event, when he goes into like the subatomic realm, and I was just so impressed with how deeply strange that imagery was.
It was so freaky.
What a great,
And beautiful.
And I'm hoping that Doctor Strange will have more of this really like bizarre kaleidoscopic imagery.
I just remember thinking it was psychedelic.
It truly was psychedelic. It was kaleidoscopic. It was, and I think that therein, they were talking about the subatomic could also be a parallel. It's string theory, basically, is what we're talking about. Quantum physics, kind of like crazy deep. Like string theory is crazy. I dare you guys to read about string theory and not get a headache.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's really crazy. You're like, you mean it's inside and curled inside of this and then sub-curled? Then, yes, that's where I exist.
John,
what?
You know, it's like... No kidding. I can't believe I'm saying this. I once spent an entire weekend trying to imagine what a universe with a fourth spatial dimension would look like, and I had the worst headache at the end of that weekend.
Guaranteed. If you want to have a headache, try that. Hey, let's move on to basically having a moment of reflection for filmmaker Wes Craven. Unfortunately, he passed away from brain cancer this past week, And we've all been talking about him. You've probably seen a lot of articles about, you know, about his work on Scream and his incredible work on the Nightmare on Elm Street series. Definitely a couple of people have written in to me and saying, hey, you should talk about Swamp Thing. I personally, one of my favorites is The Serpent and the Rainbow, which is a crazy voodoo film starring Bill Pullman. And so if you haven't seen that, that's a really, he's done a lot of different strange films. And even though he's known as like the horror guy, he spent a lot of his time trying to get out of being the horror guy, but somehow kept getting pulled back every time. He was like, well, I'm developing this musical, this and that, but then I went ahead and did Scream. Bam, you're the horror guy again. So it was like he kept getting pulled back, and I think that's really ultimately towards the end of his life he realized I'm the horror guy, and there's not anything wrong with being the horror guy. Did a lot of, you know, productions just playing himself. Wes Craven, hey, I'm Wes Craven, just like being in shows, TV shows, movies, documentaries. What are some of your thoughts about Wes Craven, John?
Well, I mean, we mentioned this on Movie Talk too, but it's like there are the greats that had great isolated performances, whether it's the performance as a writer, performance as a director, performance as an actor, and something like that. And those elevate you to a certain level. But then there's another level beyond that, that what you have created becomes a major influence on all those who come after you. Wes Craven did that twice. Once with Nightmare on Elm Street, because who doesn't reference Nightmare on Elm Street? Even in, you know, spoof horror things, everything will reference Nightmare on Elm Street. What he did with that, and you know how he basically put his character Freddy kind of at the top of the heat. I mean, there's an argument made for Michael or Jason and stuff like that. Yes, but you could totally see that Freddy would arguably be at the top of that heap, and an influence for horror that went on for decades and decades, and probably for the rest of filmmaking history. But then he did it again with Scream, and what he did with Scream, and how he turned the whole genre on its ear and kind of reflect, put up a mirror to the horror genre, put it back on itself in an entertaining and a funny kind of way. That kind of then influenced, when you look at horror films after that, you can see so many movies that were influenced by Scream and what Scream did. Very few filmmakers ever in history can say they did it once. Even fewer can ever say they did it twice. And Wes Craven did that.
Here's another weird anecdote from me. I remember this was years ago. I was at a supermarket and I saw somebody that I recognized, and I was like, oh, where have I seen this guy before? And I thought about it for like hours. Like, I didn't want to like walk up to some stranger and say, hey, have we met? And then it occurred to me about a day later that this person looked like a character from one of my favorite novels. Like, and this character from this book had been rendered so vividly in my mind that I recognized him when he walked in the room.
That's funny.
And it made me think of iconic characters. And I just want to say that, like, Wes Craven, like, he sat down in front of his typewriter one day and he just made up Freddy Krueger. Like, he just made him up, you know, like with whatever cocktail of like experiences and inspirations he had, he just made up this incredibly iconic character who is constantly referenced. If he walked in the room, we would recognize him. We know his catchphrases. You can describe his personality. And like, my goodness, he will be missed. What an artist.
The bastard son of a thousand maniacs.
Freddy Krueger, I was watching a little clip where he was basically the inspiration for Freddy Krueger was like this bully named Freddy, who used to beat him up all the time when he was a kid. So that's where he got the name Freddy.
Wow.
And then the Krueger was just like this name that stuck with him from a guy who was like muttering to himself outside of his window, Wes, when he was a little kid's window at night. And Wes looked and he saw the guy, and the guy looked at him. And he looked away. He waited for like 5 minutes and then slowly came back to the window, and the guy was still there. And the guy went like that. And he remembers that. And that gave him nightmares for, I guess, for the rest of his life, until he actually tried to exercise them in this dream nightmare character. But, you know, for me, like Wes Craven definitely gave me great nightmares, like some of my favorite nightmares when I was a kid after seeing Nightmare on Elm Street. And I loved his Hills Have Eyes. I loved Last House on the Left. I loved his take on doing horror films. Who was the writer of Scream? Was it Kevin
Williamson?
Yeah. He went on to do Dawson's Creek, I believe. But you know, his twist on the genre was a great, you know, script. And we can always see you have great scripts, but you also have to have that team. You have to have the cast, and you have to have the director who knows how to make that vision come to life. And that was something that I think Wes did great. Yeah. He was able to take things. I think the Swamp Thing that he did was a little bit of a misdirection. I think he was trying to make more of like the creature from the Black Lagoon. Mm-hmm. Because when you watch it, and even the way he's walking around with a girl and the certain scenes from it, that it was like This is before Alan Moore existed, unfortunately. 1982 is like Alan Moore hadn't taken over Swamp Thing yet to make it what it had become. I think he just started. Maybe he was just starting to write Swamp Thing in 81 or 82. I'd have to check it out, look it up. Alan Moore's very first Swamp Thing, I think, was issue 20, and then he really rewrote it, called The Anatomy Lesson, issue 21. But I think his first issue was like taking over from Len Wein, issue 19 and 20, and then when he actually put his stamp on it, it was like, hey, he was never a guy, he's always been a plant. And then they kind of tried using that later in the TV series. It never really worked out.
Yeah.
That's why I think Swamp Thing's great and ripe for an actual amazing movie, or, you know, they've already done it as a TV series. I think it would be, work great as an incredible horror film. But Wes Craven was the first guy to take Swamp Thing and do something with him.
Yep.
And so I'd love for everyone to just give a moment of reflection. Think of your favorite Wes Craven horror film and give us 10 seconds. Just think about Wes Craven. My scene that I was thinking of is when in the very first Nightmare on Elm Street, and the girl's in class, but then she kind of closes her eyes, but then she's in a dream and you don't know it at first. And she hears a goat in the hallway, like a bah, and then she walks and you see a body bag just being dragged around a corner with just the blood. Those scenes alone just make me freak out, because the dream logic that he was able to capture in just that kind of, when you have dreams and they're like always progressing and connecting and just grabbing things from your mind and trying to make sense of them, they either become a dream or they become a nightmare. It would suck to have Freddy in there.
Hey, I'll use this little bit nugget. Hey, you know.
Yeah.
So thank you, Wes Craven, for giving us Freddy Krueger. Let's move on to what I'd like to call, we already just covered Swamp Thing we were talking about. Do you guys want to add anything to that's our flashback moment? Swamp Thing, but we kind of covered it with Wes Craven.
Yeah.
I had a Swamp Thing thought. That's okay. Just thinking about Doctor Strange and about Alan Moore's run, I got to tell you, Swamp Thing Annual Number 1, I believe.
Oh, yeah.
That's the one where he goes into hell. Oh, my God. That is hands down probably one of my favorite comic books, just like individual comic books ever. And yep. I would just love to see that put on screen or animated, maybe. It was so beautiful.
You know, that's actually the basis of what Guillermo del Toro was trying to do when he was doing Justice League Dark. He was trying to take Swamp Thing Annual Number 1 because it has that circle of magic where all like Constantine and Zatanna and Mandrake the Magician, and they're all holding hands to bind this evil force when Swamp Thing goes back to get his true love, Abigail, and take her from, I think it's Beelzebub or some horrendous creature. Arcane is in there, just living on a mountain of rotting flesh. Some of the most horrifying images, some of my favorite horror artists who ever exist and still exist on the planet, John Tottlebin, Rick Veitch, Steven Bissett, just killed it on that entire run of Swamp Thing. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, What he just mentioned, Swamp Thing Annual Number 1, get on eBay, get that right now. That is one of the greatest horror stories ever written. It's self-contained too, so it's 48 pages of flavor, and it's great.
Oh, and that one character, that one bad guy who he meets, and he says, "Oh, tell me how many untold eons I've been here."
No, that's Swamp Arcane.
Thing. Yeah. Oh, and he says, "You've been here since yesterday."
And he's like, "Ah!" Just starts screaming.
Yep.
Violently horrible. Thanks for mentioning that. That's great.
I got my uses.
All right. Hey, so now we're gonna move on to what I like to call minor mutations. This week on Minor Mutations, number one, we've got Batman and Joker. They're back again for more Suicide Squad filming. We've also got Tony Todd playing Zoom in Flash, and also Flash meets Earth 2's Flash Jay Garrick. So there's a lot of Flash action going on. We've got Spider-Man. He might be getting his armor. He might be getting his web shooters from Tony Stark in Civil War. We're hearing rumors about that. Supergirl's Melissa Benoist is the picture was went all around the internet. Her holding little puppies with little kids with Superman. It was like you can't even see that. That's the cutest Superman image, Supergirl image I've ever seen in my life. Wanted to kill myself after I saw that. And then finally, we've got Lois Lane. It's Lucy Lane. She's been cast in Supergirl. Speaking of Supergirl, any of these things catch your guys' fancy to talk about?
Well, I mean, the thing that, from what I understand, I've been reading up a bunch on it. There is no rumor that Tony Stark is going to create the spider armor. From what I actually read is the rumor that's going around is that it's definitely not in there. But the rumor is that Tony Stark may, in Captain America Civil War, create the web slingers. I still don't know how they go that deep into the story of Spider-Man, considering he wasn't even cast when the movie started shooting and he wasn't around when the movie finished shooting. So I'm not sure. But from what I understood, I read a couple of reports and they were like, it's not that Tony Stark creates armor for Spider-Man, because that's way too advanced of a story for this juncture. But he might create his web slingers. So that's interesting.
What do you think, Robert?
That sounds like a cool idea. I'm excited about Tony Todd playing Zoom. Just him doing anything. He can do whatever he likes. He's great. You know, I'm pumped about that. And yeah, that was my main thought.
Yeah, for me, it was that Supergirl picture with her with the puppies and the kids. Yeah. That's just literally like... And that's actually what I like about that Supergirl series. It's the 'cause
you've seen the pilot.
Yeah, and I really like the pilot because I liked it had these Whedon-esque moments. It had this, not corny, but just a different sensibility. Like it's like fun. And to see that picture is what I think a lot of people complained about with Man of Steel, which I didn't have any problems with. I loved Man of Steel. I had some story issue points, but overall I thought it was a great reboot of the character, and I'm glad they're continuing with that and moving into that with that tone that Zack Snyder kept with the Man of Steel moving into Batman v Superman. But Supergirl can be this other thing, and I think this other thing is that lighter, fun version of Superman, Superboy, Supergirl, Superwoman, whatever you want to call it, that version of this character with those powers. Hopefully they're going to have that kind of tone with it. And just to see that picture made me smile.
It's a really great picture, and this is a great time to plug the fact that here on Collider Video, we are launching a recap show network, and one of the shows that we'd be doing weekly recap shows for is the new Supergirl, so keep your eyes open for that.
Yeah, there's also, they're going to be doing Arrow,
Flash, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., and then outside of the hero realm, we're also doing Blacklist and Empire, so six shows we're going to be launching with, and Supergirl is one of them.
Right on. So now we're going to move into what I like to call Spotlight, where we take a character or a group of comic book characters who have not been transformed into media like television or movies yet. This week, we are going to cover The Authority. So Warren Ellis and Brian Hitch breathed brand new life into some Wildstorm characters when they launched this hyper-violent, more realistic amalgam of the Justice League meeting the Avengers team, and they called it The Authority. This was the brand new lightning strike crackle of the widescreen comics that was then dubbed by some people, you know, who were reading the comics at that time. Let's talk about The Authority. Robert, what are your thoughts about The Authority when it first launched off?
Oh, I thought it was just such like a fresh take on these archetypes, you know, like, 'cause you've got like these basic archetypes and sort of like primary superhero lore, right? The guy with the cape, the guy with the gadgets, you know, the Batman character. And I thought it was really thoughtful. And it had a great sense of play that I liked. Like, I think it was even Alan Moore did a run on, was it Supreme for Image Comics? Mm-hmm. And I remember that whole character. I remember it had this very, I mean, it was cool, but it didn't have as much of like a sense of play or fun that I felt like this had. So this would be a good one.
Definitely. John?
I thought you were talking, as soon as you said The Authority, I thought you were talking about that thing going on in the WWE. There's a big wrestling group called The Authority. So I thought you were going that way. I never, like, most of my comic reading, actually 95% of my comic reading was all the mainstream stuff that I was just, so The Authority is one I heard of. My buddy Rod, up in Canada, I believe, came to me and he talked to me about that one, but it's just not one I ever picked up.
Right on. Well, definitely, if you're going to pick it up, check out Warren Ellis and Brian Hitch's 12-issue run. And then Mark Millar and Frank Quitely did another 12-issue run. So those are the prime stories that I would say, if you want to check this out, to start with that. But start with Warren Ellis and Brian Hitch. Brian Hitch is really well known as the guy who jumped off from The Authority and then did The Ultimates. He did the artwork for The Ultimates, which is basically the reboot of The Avengers, which is what the movie The Avengers was based on, was The Ultimates version of The Avengers. But for me, The Authority was great, mainly because of what Warren Ellis was trying to do. Warren Ellis is a fantastic writer, but what he was doing was, he was like, I'm bringing what he dubbed, after people talked about, widescreen comics. Why he called them widescreen comics is because, not just because the panels were compositionally what, you know, wide or big budget, but because he was saying, what we can do in comics, you can never do in movies or television. We have unlimited budgets. We can blow up planets. We can have 400 spacecraft. We can have whatever we can imagine. So when he started broaching those subjects and bringing like these mega budget scenarios to each of these 4-issue story arcs, that's kind of what he was doing with The Authority. So it's a lot of fun. It's also a lot of fun that they were like playing with archetypes, like you said. They basically had a Batman his name was Midnighter, and they had a Superman whose name was Apollo, and they were a gay couple. And so a lot of people freaked out. They're like, how dare you do that with your mom and your mom? And it's like, relax, man. It's like comic book characters. Plus, guess what? There are real gay people, too. That happens.
What?
Believe it or not.
So, yeah. It's crazy if they had them in comic books. So anyway, once again, that was many years ago. Now it's just like, it's part of the norm. You have gay characters all over the place, right. And it's not weird. But that was kind of like people were a little freaked out by it like 15 years ago. So once again, I think the Authority would make an incredible, giant, big budget movie. It's got to be at least 100 million. So, all right, let's move on to Twitter questions. This week, we've got the first one's from the Movie Dude. What classic actors do you think could play a superhero now with hindsight? I always thought Gregory Peck would be a great Batman. Let's stick with that. Who, like an old actor, minus Clint Eastwood, because that's just too easy. An old actor that you think would play Batman, and then give me an old actor that you think would be good at playing Wonder Woman.
Can I offer a different character entirely?
Sure, why not?
Along with Wonder Woman? Sure. Over on my nerd website, CC Duque, I don't know, I think you know it, John.
Sure.
Jon Schnepp. I wrote an article where I cast the Justice League in the Adam West verse.
Ah, nice.
Because I think that's a really fun universe. It's very well done.
66, 67.
Right? Oh, yeah, totally. And I just tried to cast people who were roughly around the right age around that time. And the one that I was that I would have been most excited to see was that era's Kurt Russell playing Hal Jordan. And nice. I also cast as a Wonder Woman, I would have cast Nichelle Nichols.
Right on.
Back in the day.
What about you?
I've said this for a while. I mean, I think he's in his 70s now, so I think it's safe to say that I've thought for a long time that Sylvester Stallone would be a great Dark Knight Returns Batman.
Hmm.
Although he is quite short for it, so I always thought that would be great. And the one that I could see, like an actress from an era gone by who could play Wonder Woman, Katharine Hepburn. Nice. I can totally see Katharine Hepburn as Wonder Woman.
I was going to say Steve McQueen is Batman and Robert Redford is Superman.
Yeah.
Oh, Redford would have been
Batman
a great
be
Superman,
yeah. But yeah. From the 70s, that would have been pretty crazy. Early 70s.
Do you two want to know who I would cast if I had an unlimited budget right now to do The Dark Knight Returns as a movie, who I would cast as Clark Kent?
Sure.
I would cast Bruce Campbell.
Oh, yeah. Well, he's got the jaw, the whole bit.
His
hair's
kind of going gray.
I always thought they almost modeled that after him.
Yeah, right?
I mean, the arrow was offset, but I mean, he totally does look like Clark Kent.
He could pull it off. But, you know, remember Frank Miller, the way he wrote Superman, it wasn't comedic. It was more of just like the straight man who listened to Ronald Reagan.
I would sit on him.
You could make that funny today.
Yeah, I think you could.
So I would have him play it straight, have him like hit the weights. I think it'd be great. Yeah.
All right, let's move on. Wesley Taylor asks, do you guys think that Spider-Man, the animated Spider-Man series theme, will ever be used in the new movies?
Nope.
What do you think?
I can't imagine. However, when I read this question, I thought of the Ed Norton Incredible Hulk movie,
right.
And just how liberally they drew from the TV show's imagery and mythos, which kind of makes me think the TV show is part of the MCU, like retroactively. So I agree with you, probably not, but why not?
Well, also, Sam Raimi already did like a very kind plug in the very first Spider-Man where he had a street musician, Spider-Man,
yeah, it was
just playing
like
it on the guitar.
The
that's
yeah.
a tip of the hat. I think that's as much as any of us ever want to see unless you're watching that 60s show, because that's what we grew up. I grew up watching. That's the only Spider-Man that existed was like that limited animation Spider-Man. So I'm glad we've gotten so many other amazing Spider-Man things to watch since then. But, you know, if you want to hear that, you know, that jingle, just type it in, Google, check it out. That's the best way you're going to hear it. You're not going to hear it in the movies. So, all right, let's move on. Cam Deeble says, regarding Batman v Superman, could the soldiers wearing the Superman armbands be Snyder's version of the mutants' sons of Batman? Sort of going once again back to the Dark Knight Returns.
Yeah, no, we said this on the show a while ago. I really believe that they work for Lex Luthor. And I believe, like you see when in that one shot in the first trailer came out, when Superman comes down to that sewer tunnel, right. So thing, you know, those guys, those soldiers kneel down, but there's a look of disgust on Superman's face. I don't think Superman has anything to do with them. I don't think he wants to have anything to do with them. I think they are like a new government sort of thing, or specifically a private security firm, like a private militia of Lex Luthor. And he's somehow controlling Superman. Like, I don't think mind controlling, but he's got some kind of leverage on Superman. So I don't think it is. It's a really cool theory, and I totally see why he came up with it, but I don't think it fits what we know so far.
That is a good idea. And John, that's a really good thought. And I have to say, that would be a very Luthor move to create some kind of fascistic militia group to make Superman look like more of a fascist, to sully his public image. I feel like that's something Luthor would do, you know?
Right. That he basically has an army.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. There's one scene in the trailer too where Superman is kneeling in front of Lex Luthor.
Yes. Yeah.
And he's running his hand over his hair, and as he looks up at Luthor, he's got that totally pissed off, disgusted look on his face as he's looking at Luthor. So I'm really curious to find out what that's all about.
Yeah, that has to be a scene where Lex has something over him, and he basically was like doing the reverse of Zod, like kneel before Luthor. There's something there which we don't know what it is, but we'll find out in 7 months. All right. Mackenzie Posabon asks, do you guys think the MCU, DCCU have become less grounded and realistic? Does that lose dramatic tension? Thanks.
Well, Marvel's always felt more otherworldly, and that works for them, and there's nothing wrong with that. Are both of them heading in a direction where they're becoming less grounded in reality? Yeah, because that's kind of the way, it's the law of diminishing returns. It's kind of where you got to. As soon as you made a commitment to having a space opera in Guardians of the Galaxy, as soon as you decided, we're going to do Doctor Strange and all that kind of stuff, will it lose some of the dramatic element? Yes, but there's different types of dramatic element. They can create something completely different, and I think they will. It's more important with DC, though, because DC, they've come out and said themselves, this isn't us attributing it to them, they've come out and said themselves, we are more grounded. Mm-hmm. And if they can find a way, and I thought Man of Steel, despite the fact that it was about an alien from another planet, it felt very grounded to me. Despite the fact that we have an Amazonian, descendant of the Greek gods coming into the whole realm here, despite the fact that we're going to have the King of Atlantis coming into it and all that kind of stuff, if they can find a way to do what they did in Man of Steel and keep it feeling grounded, once again, the fantastic within the mundane, if they can find a way to really pull that off, it's going to be something special. So let's see how they're able to navigate this.
Yeah, I really wonder how... I myself have found, like with Avengers Age of Ultron, where they're all fighting a bunch of robots, there's no real tension. Because honestly, I felt the Avengers pulled that off great. They had these mindless ant creatures called the Chitauri that are being controlled by this other nebulous dark force on another, rift opened planet, dimensional, whatever the heck they were, transporting giant dragon, floating snake things. It was cool. And then they all get turned off or whatever when the main, little transmitter gets blown up. Same exact thing happens.
And the battleship and the battle droids in the prequels, yes.
Yeah, so it gets a little tiresome, and it's maybe it's because I'm not 12 or I don't know why, but it's like I don't want to see that happen in Civil War. I don't want them to fight a bunch of weird drones where there's no stakes.
Yeah.
And that's what happens, and that is the law of diminishing returns, where, like with Ant-Man, he's got to fight another ant, smaller guy.
Right.
With Hulk, he's got to fight another Hulk. With Iron Man, he's got to fight another Iron Man. So, with Doctor Strange, he's got to fight another version of Doctor Strange, which is Mordu. So you have these opposite mirror reflections for a reason. Just like in Batman, you had the Joker, the original Tim Burton Batman. You created me, I created you first, this yin-yang. And it just makes sense when you're working within the movie construct. The movie construct is only 2 hours. You have Act 1, Act 2, Act 3. You have the antagonist, you have the protagonist. It works within story structure. That's why it works. But, echo what Martin from Game of Thrones, the author, was saying, he's like, can't we have a little change up? I'd like to see a little change up. And, we were making fun of him a couple weeks ago when he said that. But I do agree with him that, we have to have these introductions, but then the change up is what makes things more interesting.
Later on.
So I think hopefully we'll see that change up happening with Infinity Gauntlet. When we're entering these different cosmic worlds, we're going to be able to play up and the change up a little bit more is going to happen. So I think that's a great question. Next question, we've got Alberto Diaz basically asks, have you heard anything about the Titans pilot over at TNT? What do you think? What do you want to see on the show? The Teen Titans pilot. Basically, they've got a Teen Titans pilot. And what I'd like to see for the Teen Titans, I had a giant run of Marv Wolfman, George Perez, Teen Titans. Nothing exists before that. Nothing exists after that. That's, for me, the ultimate Teen Titans run. We're talking about Terra. Yep. We're talking about stories that, if you don't know what I'm talking about, you got to get on and read that, because that is some amazing writing and incredible artwork and some of the best soap opera style comic book writing that I ever have. I can't even explain to you how much I appreciated that for what it is. It's not The Dark Knight. It's not The Watchmen. It's not this epic yarn of violence that culminates in it. It's cool storytelling about teens, you know, who are superheroes fighting bad guys. But it's really, really well done. What do you think, Robert?
I was going to say, I want to go on record as saying that recently when Jon Schnepp was offloading some of his old comic book collection, I bought that specific run from you. Because that, like, I can remember being a kid. My older siblings had comics, and I remember they had that whole run there, and I just devoured the entire thing. That perfect George Perez artwork. You
so
know?
Awesome. I forgot. Oh, that when I was raising money for The Death of Superman Lives, I put a bunch of my comics on the block. And they were entire runs of things that I've read through and through time and time again, but really in good condition. And I'm so happy that you got that run. I forgot about that.
Love it. Just love it. And as far as a Teen Titans show, like if it could draw from that run, I think it'd be cool to see like another window into the into like the Gotham City universe. It'd be great to see Dick Grayson up on screen, like get his perspective on things.
Right.
I would love to see. And well, they couldn't do Trigon, could they? That'd be too much money. But
well, maybe they
who
could.
Knows? Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
There's the characters Raven. You have Cyborg. You have Nightwing.
Changeling.
Starfire. Yeah. Beast Boy slash Beast Changeling. Boy. Yeah, yeah. I think that was pretty much it. What do you think, John?
Stupid, 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 stupid. This is a terrible idea.
Wait. Sorry, you didn't read this either, right?
No,
you didn't
I
read
did.
Any of the comics
oh, I
that
did.
I mentioned.
It was a mainstream one. Right. I read it, right. And it's a stupid idea. This is a terrible idea. I hope it never sees the light of day. I think it is going to see the light of day, but I haven't heard much as far as the movement goes on lately. I do think it's going to happen. I think it's a terrible idea. Now, having said that, let me call myself out. There's another show I said was a terrible idea, and I thought was going to be stupid, and that was The Flash. I thought that was going to be stupid. I said, it's a dumb idea. Just stick with Arrow, blah, blah. You know, The Flash, you can't do that as a TV series. It's going to be ridiculous. It's only the best comic book series on TV right now. So,
why do you think it's going to be a bad idea?
I think it's going to be too juvenile, to be honest. I think it's desperate. I think it smells desperate doing it. It feels like, oh, God, we got to find something else to do now because it's a hot thing right now.
Right.
I just think it's going to come across as silly and juvenile and dumb. Many of the things that I said Flash was going to come across as.
I'll play devil's advocate, though, and say that I'm liking it because I'm hoping they're adapting this version of the series that I love from the 80s, and they could not be doing that at all. It could be completely different. So I'm liking it for not even the right reasons because I don't know enough about it, especially if there's a pilot. I haven't seen or heard anything about it. So I guess the jury's out until they decide to air the pilot or they go to series and we get to actually check it out. But up until then, I'm still hoping that they're using, you know, Marv Wolfman and George Perez's story blocks. That would be a very smart thing. Any young executives who don't know what I'm talking about, why don't you read those and then erase the pilot you already shot and do a new one. So, all right. We already got this, but this is one of the... Any chance Mads Mikkelsen may be playing Dormammu? I'd say bingo. This is my guess. But then I said, if he's not Dormammu, I would personally cast him as Nightmare, which is a character who appeared in the very first appearance of Doctor Strange. I think it was like Strange Tales 126 or 136. One of those, his very first appearance, a guy came to Doctor Strange. It's like, I've gone to all these different doctors. No one knows what the problem is. I can't sleep. Someone suggested I come to you. Can you help me? I'm having all these nightmares. And Doctor Strange goes into his astral form and goes into this guy's brain, basically while he's having a nightmare, and encounters this character called Nightmare, who looks sort of like Mads Mikkelsen. So Mads Mikkelsen, that's my guess, but I'm pretty much thinking he's Dormammu. What do you think?
Well, I mean, it's absolutely, he could. I mean, if the question is, could he be? Sure, he could be, but I mean, he could be Mephisto, he could be Blackheart, he could be Nightmare, he could be, there's a lot of guys he could be. We simply just don't know, but is it a possibility that it could be him? Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a good chance.
You just could have nailed it, man. If he plays Mephisto.
Yeah, Mephisto, he would be a deadly Mephisto.
Then that's a good call.
That's
a
really good call. I haven't even heard that yet, because if he plays Mephisto, then he can cross over in all these different movies, not just Doctor Strange. He can cross over. He could be in the Defenders if they wanted to get mystical or whatever.
Yeah.
What do you think?
That was my first guess, but I like it. I like the idea of him playing Mephisto too. That'd be great. And like a really cool take on that character too. You know, far less, I mean, it'd be nice to see him like a step less campy than he's presented in the comics, but
Hey, I'm wearing my red pajama bottoms.
Right.
Like Mephisto always has the floppy Dr. Seuss little floppy socks. I'm like, you're Mephisto. Can't you get an upgrade? All right. because Mephisto likes to be comfortable when he's in the ninth level of hell.
Dang it.
All right. Langley M. Neely asks, looking at DC and Marvel's future slate, which film interests you the least and is most likely to be canceled, and why? So I guess we're talking about movies here. Marvel and DC's, their future slate, they've already lined up everything, I think, up to 2020. What would you guess, if any, would they cancel? Say Batman v Superman doesn't do what they thought it would be. What's the one that they are like announced already that's going to get canned from DC? And say Marvel, they have two misfires, like Black Panther doesn't work out, right, and you know, whatever. What's another one that they've already announced?
Captain Marvel.
Inhumans. Both of those don't. Yeah. That doesn't hit it. What do you think they're going to pull if they did pull anything?
Well, the one, there was two questions there. Which one interests me the least and which one do I think? The one that interests me the least right now is Wonder Woman, for all the reasons we talked about before. That could change radically, though, if they're able to kill it with Batman vs. Superman. If there was one that I had to guess is the most likely to be canceled, I don't think they're canceling Aquaman. I don't think they're going to cancel this one either, but if you're asking me which is the most likely, Cyborg. It's probably the least known of these characters, right, things like that. So I would guess, and I don't think they're going to cancel that one either. I'm just saying if I had to guess, that would be my guess.
I had the same thoughts, and all of those thoughts bummed me out, because the prospect of having like a Cyborg-led movie is a great one. Having a Wonder Woman movie is also great, but it seems like those would be the most expendable from the DC movie slate. As far as Marvel, like the same title sprang to mind, Inhumans. You know, like they're not going to, they're not going to cancel Guardians of the Galaxy 2, I wouldn't think.
No, that's an automatic. Yeah, but Inhumans is an interesting one, because they seem to have plans for Inhumans right now, but they're using Inhumans a lot in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. And if Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. botches, if they pull out Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. season one in season three and they completely botch the Inhumans, that could put the Inhumans, all the Inhumans plans on the chopping block, theoretically.
Yeah, I find that the length of the time that we have to wait for the Inhumans, I think it's 2019.
2018 like
feels
that.
Like forever. But and that they're introducing the Terrigen mists and all these things, the things that turn you into a mutant, inhuman. It's the way Marvel is basically, we're going to reappropriate all of our mutants and just call them Inhumans. You guys can keep the X-Men. We're going to have our own toys and video games of the Inhumans. They're going to make the Inhumans as popular, or they're going to try to make the Inhumans as popular as the X-Men comics were.
Tall order.
It is a very tall order, and the wrong way to do it is how they're doing it. They're introducing Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. using this okay series. Some are better than others. You know, I haven't watched the entire series, but I've watched a couple of the episodes, and some of them I found really fun, like with Kyle MacLachlan and certain, you know, elements of Hydra. You know, the Bill Paxton, fantastic. So there's certain character actors in that series that I really appreciate. I was like, oh my god, that Sif episode was fun. But then you have a bunch of other episodes where you're like, what's going on? This is not working out for me. So. Right. I don't know. Like I said, I haven't watched a lot of them. I've watched, maybe like eight out of the two seasons, and now they're on to their third season. But I did watch the ones where they introduced the Inhumans and the Mist, and that one girl kind of turned into the Porcupine Lady, whatever her name was.
Yeah.
You know, and the other girl who was an agent kind of became like, you know, whenever I get excited, things explode, whatever her power is.
There's a pun joke in there somewhere, but I'm going to leave it alone.
So, you know, hopefully you're right. If they botch it in season three, there's no undoing the botch, except that they're like, we're now separate universes, you know, or something. A time rift has opened, you know, or so, you know, they're going to have to explain O-Vision the stuff. I don't know. But all right, let's move on to our last question. It's the sweaty question of the week, and it's from Ray De Jesus. He asks, can you explain the difference between vibranium and adamantium on the next Heroes? Well, here we go. So the difference is Fox, they own vibranium. They own adamantium. Adamantium is the steel that is used in Wolverine's exoskeleton. They've covered his bones with adamantium. Now, in the Marvel comic books, that's also what Cap's shield was made of, but they changed it to vibranium because they don't own adamantium anymore. So they had to basically kind of weave in vibranium into the Marvel universe, which actually worked great because vibranium already existed only in Wakanda, which is Black Panther's, hometown. That's where, hey, if you want vibranium, you got to go to Wakanda. So basically, that's how Claw exists. A whole bunch of these different characters, that was their origin, was using vibranium. So they just were clever enough to be able to kind of integrate vibranium into the overall Marvel universe and just kind of forget about adamantium. Did I get that right, guys?
That sounds about right, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, and also I think it's on the scale of which is harder. I believe adamantium is supposed to be the most indestructible metal they have. Vibranium is supposed to be near indestructible. Hence, you see Captain Shield getting broken. Help me out. I can't remember if in any of the Marvel runs was adamantium ever alien in origin, because I thought I know the one movie said it was a mineral that was actually in a series of comets that hit the Earth, but I can't remember if any of the actual comic runs ever said that was the origin of the metal either. So one of the differences might be one is naturally terra-bound, one might not be, but I can't remember if the comics ever backed that up or not. I can't remember any that did.
I'm drawing a blank on that. I do remember that Ultron was made of adamantium, and they had to change it for the movies to be vibranium because. Yeah. Joe Costa was also made of, who was like the female version, the all like, she's made of adamantium as well. But I guess if they ever introduce her in the movie version, she's going to be made of vibranium, but they're running out of it. I guess there's a very limited amount. And I guess Ulysses Claw's got it.
Everybody's got it.
Everyone has it. There's enough to make a gigantic Ultron suit out of it. They're like, it's very, very low supply. What? It's a giant mountain of vibranium. Yeah. So there we go. That's the sweaty question of the week. I'd like to thank the guests. Robert J. Peterson, where can people find you online?
You can go to californiacoldblood.com. That's my sci-fi and fantasy publishing imprint of Rare Bird Books, and also at robertjpeterson.com.
And what's the book that you've got that's out right now that people can get?
My novel, The Odds. It's been out for coming up on a year, and it's doing pretty well. You can find it wherever books are sold, and of course, online. And California Cold Blood's next release is by a wonderful author, Adam Kornman. He's a captain in the U.S. Army, and he wrote this great military sci-fi novel, When the Stars Fade. So that's going to be coming out in November.
What an awesome title.
Isn't that a nice title?
That is an awesome title.
That's awesome. John Campea, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter and on Facebook by following me at John Campea. Of course, you can find me Monday through Friday on our kind of our main flagship show, Collider Movie Talk, with John Schnepp as well. And I'll be making an announcement next week about my own little book project. So that's right. Looking forward to announcing that.
I don't want to tip the cat out of the bag, but check whatever he's talking about. It's going to be on Kickstarter. So I'm excited about it. I think it's a fantastic idea. I'll let him announce it, but I'm excited for him to do this.
I've never heard anybody say tip the cat out of the bag. Like you're mixing the
I totally mixed it all together, made my own little sandwich. You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram just at John Schnepp and at TDOSLWH. You can find my film, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, by going to www.tdoslwh.com. You can get a digital version or a Blu-ray right now. Support independent film. I will see you guys next week on episode 24 of Heroes. This has been episode 23. Check it out.